cinnamon bell.
Judy and Jimmy, with Cinnamon Bear and the Crazy Quilt Dragon, are still in the Wishing Woods. Queen Melissa's magic instructions for restoring their broken star to one piece directed them to the Wishing Well, where the Cinnamon Bear took it upon himself to do a bit of investigating. However, he carried his investigation too far. As a matter of fact, he carried it clear to the bottom of the well. He leaned over too far and tumbled head over paws down, down, down to the very bottom of the Wishing Well.
Oh, poor Cinnamon Bear.
Gee willikers, how will you ever get him out? It's deeper than anything.
Hello down there, Patty O'Cinnamon.
Yoo-hoo! Patty, can you hear us?
Hello. I can't hear you.
Are you all right?
Yes, but I'd surely like to get out of this awful place.
Is there any water down there?
No, but it's freezing cold. Brr, I don't like it one little bit. Thank goodness my extra special stuffing kept me from getting hurt.
Hang on down there, Cinnamon Bear, and don't be frightened. We'll get you out in no time.
But however will we do it, Crazy Quilt?
Let me see now. If we only had a rope.
But there wouldn't be any ropes around here.
Quite true. But we might look around for a tree branch to put down the well. He could scramble up on that.
All right, let's look.
How about this, Crazy Quilt?
Oh, it's too big for any of us to lift.
Well, here's one that's small enough.
Oh, no, that's dead. It would snap right under him.
I don't see anything else we could use. Do you, Jimmy?
No, not a thing. Say, I've got an idea.
What?
This is a wishing well, isn't it?
Of course it is. You know that.
Well, why don't we just wish him out?
Splendid. My, you're the smart one, Jimmy. Now, why didn't I think of that?
Look, there's a sign over here on this side of the well. I can't read it because it's kind of dark-like. Can you read it, Crazy Quilt?
Just a minute. Sure enough. Why, it's some instructions for using the wishing well.
Jiminy Crickets, hurry up and read them.
Let's see. Wishing well wishes you well. Wish your wish and wait the spell.
Oh, hooray! Now we can save poor Cinnamon Bear.
Oh, wait. Here's a P.S. Be you 1 or 28. A single wish is all you rate. Oh, gracious me, this is the dreadful.
Why, Crazy Quilt?
Well, Melissa's instructions said the wishing well is where to go to find out what you want to know. And we wanted to know how to get the broken silver star back together again, didn't we?
Sure we did.
I'm positive Melissa meant for us to use the wish for that purpose.
And the sign says we can only have one wish. So if we use it to pull Cinnamon Bear out of the well, we won't be able to get the star fixed.
That's what it amounts to, Jimmy.
Well, I don't care. We've just got to get dear Patio Cinnamon out of that black old well. Of course, I'll feel awful about not getting our beautiful silver star mended. But Cinnamon Bear is our friend, and we can't leave him there. So we'll just hurry up and wish him out.
That's your privilege, Judy, but it seems to me that his carelessness doesn't deserve such loyalty. And remember, Christmas is getting closer and closer and closer. So if you expect...
Oh, dear. I don't know what to say. But poor Patty. I've just got to help him. Wishing well, I wish the Cinnamon Bear to be up here with us right this very minute.
Oh, am I glad to be out of that. Excuse me just a moment while I shake out my extra special stuffing a bit.
We're so glad to see you again, Cinnamon Bear.
You bet. For a while, you had us pretty worried.
I hope you're satisfied, Patty Old Cinnamon, now that you've ruined the children's chances for getting their silver star fixed.
What do you mean? Say that again, you miserable excuse for a bed quilt.
Gladly, you cheap imitation fur coat.
What's that? Hold your tongue there, or I'll growl my most ferocious growl at you.
Ferocious growl, indeed. You do better to hang your stuffed head in shame. Judy and Jimmy have used up the only wish they can have just to fish you out of the well.
Is this true?
Well, just sort of.
It doesn't matter, Cinnamon Bear. You couldn't help it.
Oh, Judy. Jimmy, I'm so terribly sorry. I don't know what to say.
Now everything's going to be all right. And we'll get the Silver Star all fixed when we go back to Melissa and explain how we used up our wish.
Sure we will. Melissa's awful nice. She'll help us out again.
And speaking of helping us out, what do you say we help us out of the Wishing Woods?
That's the first sensible thing you've said in 5 minutes, Crazy Quilt. Oh, look. There's a sort of a path over there. It's not a very good one, but at least we can try it.
Might as well. Even if it doesn't take us out of the woods, maybe it will lead us to somebody who can tell us the way.
Spoken like a true pioneer, Jimmy. Onward!
It's an awful narrow path, Crazy Quilt. I think we'd all better go single file.
Oh, but definitely, Judy. I'm not at all anxious to have my beautiful patches torn by this underbrush.
Hey, I think I can see out of the woods.
Already? Why, this is the best luck we've had in ever so long.
The trees aren't so thick now, and I think there's a clear place ahead.
That will be a relief indeed.
What's the matter, Crazy? Have you been scared because it was so dark?
One more word out of you, Fuzzy Pants, and I'm very liable to forego my usual composure and paddle your cinnamon trousers for you.
Oh, yes?
I don't think we can get out this way.
Why not, Jimmy?
Well, there's nothing out here but mud. As far as I can see either way, mud.
Let me look. Jumping jellyfish. It's mud for a fact.
Bless my Crazy Quilt aunt if it isn't. A regular river of mud probably runs the whole length of the woods.
It doesn't look very wide.
No, but it's too wide to jump across, and I couldn't swim in that stuff. Ugh, it's thick and oozy, and no telling how deep. I'll have to draw the line there.
Oh, I see a sign over there, Cinnamon Bear.
What does it say?
Private. No muddling. Oh, my goodness.
I wonder what that could be. Well, say, which one of you threw that mud at me? Right in the eye.
Don't look at me. Though I might have the inclination, I'd hardly lower myself to mudslinging.
Jimmy and I wouldn't do it, Cinnamon Bear.
Well, who did it then? I'd like to know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, my gracious. Look at that.
What are they?
Willikers. They look something like people, only they're all made out of mud. And they're 3 times bigger than we are.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's only 2 of them, thank goodness. But, oh, they're awful looking.
Let me handle them. This takes diplomacy. Greetings, fellow travelers. Who might you be?
Yeah, yeah. We're the Muddlers. Here's how.
Whoa. Oh, you ruffians. Throw mud at Crazy Quilt, will you?
Yeah. And here's for the rest of you.
Oh, Jimmy, don't let
them do it. You bet I won't. Hey, you let my sister alone, you dirt and water bums.
Let him have it. He insulted us.
Right, Captain McMud.
Ha ha, miss me.
What's wrong, Muttley? Losing your grip?
Sorry, Captain. Better luck this time. Yeah, here's mud in your eye.
Missed again.
Oh, Jimmy, I'm afraid. They're so big and ugly.
Wait a bit, dirty face. What prompts all this vicious mudslinging? I've never been so Oh, my beautiful color.
We need target practice, don't we, Captain McMud?
Huh? We'll teach you to come around our sacred mud baths.
Oh, got me again. Just where can I get my paws on you?
How you doing, Muddley?
Fair to muddling, Captain. Got that fuzzy beast square on the schnozzola.
He certainly did. I'm a cinnamon mess.
If your mother could only see you now.
I think we'll have to run for it. These muddlers are nasty creatures. Come on, children, back into the woods.
No, you don't. They're trying to get away, Muddley. Head them off.
Okay, Captain. Shall I yell for the rest of the mud gods?
No, we can handle them.
Maybe they'd let us go if we gave them something.
We haven't got anything to give them.
How about your little looking glass, Judy?
Yes, I'll try that. Would you muddlers let us alone if I gave you this pretty looking glass?
No, we don't want you to give us nothing. But here's something for you.
Oh, dear, got me again.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Poor Crazy Quilt. You're keeping those awful muddlers from hitting us.
Oh, that's all right. Glad to help. Well, Patio Cinnamon, what are you doing for the cause?
I'm thinking I am. Strategist, that's me.
Indeed? And what... Ouch! And what piece of strategy have you cooked up?
Well, it's coming. I'll tell you when I got it straight.
Well, if it's going to do us any good, you'd better get it soon.
Ouch! I got it.
So I noticed right on the nose.
No, not that. I mean the idea. Judy, try the magic lunchbox. See if they'll let us go if you give it to them.
I'll try, Patty. Please, Mr. Muddlers, Look what I've got for you.
Yeah? Well, what is it?
It's a specially magical box with all sorts of goodies in it. Cookies and sandwiches and...
Sandwiches!
Oh. Hey, get out!
What's the matter? Wouldn't you like that?
No. We never eat anything but mud pies.
Oh, dear. Whatever can we do now?
Come on, Muddley. I'm fed up throwing mud. Let's give them the wipes.
You mean push them in the mud river?
Yeah, shove them in. Let them soak a while. Then we'll come back and make mud statues out of them.
No, no, don't. Jimmy, they're coming after us.
Chance, they've got us.
Oh, we're in for it now.
Yeah, you mean you're in it now. Help yourselves, friends. We'll be back after you're all soaked up.
Yeah.
Are you all right, Judy?
Oh, Jimmy, I can't touch bottom, and I just keep sinking.
Cinnamon Bear's got his mouth full of mud.
Climb on my back, everybody. Come on, Judy, Jimmy.
There.
You made it, Paddy. Now I'll try and swim.
Please do, Crazy Quilt. Please do. You've just got to.
Can you do it, Crazy Quilt? Can you?
I can't make it.
Jimmy, we're sinking.
Oh, dear.
This looks mighty serious, doesn't it? That mud is awfully thick and black, and goodness knows how deep it is. Will Crazy Quilt be able to get them out? Well, let's just hope they can keep their heads up until next time so we can find out what happens.
Presenting The Christmas Eve Ghost, another in a series of radio plays based on stories featured in the American Weekly, the magazine which is distributed with all Hearst's Sunday newspapers from coast to coast. The Christmas Eve Ghost was produced in the New York studios of the General Broadcasting Company. Men of the sea are superstitious, even more so than landsmen. The sky, the swell of the ocean surface, birds wheeling and screaming around a ship, all these apparently innocent details have certain ominous interpretations for your sailor man, so it's not surprising that there should be wild tales of haunted ships and shipwrecks which lie fathoms deep or beached on the sandy shores off the New England coast. In the middle of the last century, no sturdier, smarter, five-masted schooner ever sailed the seas than the Ruth I. Brown. Her skipper, a huge, brawny seaman named Cobb, as good a captain as ever ordered a four-tack heave down, had one outstanding characteristic. He was deeply religious. Too religious to suit his men, he always carried a parson on board ship to hold services. One blustery Christmas Eve, the skipper was sitting in his cabin, reading aloud to himself.
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. Come in.
If you please, Captain.
Come in, Mr. Willebrand. Come in. I was just reading a bit of the scriptures.
Aye, Captain. But if you...
Sit down, mate, and listen.
But, Captain...
Sit down.
Aye, sir.
I'm reading from the second chapter of Luke, where the angel appeared to the shepherds. And the angel said unto them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior."
Captain?
"And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." That's what the good book says, mate.
Aye, sir.
"And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host." You know what that means?
No, sir.
Well, that means there was a flock of spirits appeared. You believe in spirits, don't you?
The bottle kind I does, Captain.
Damn it, mate. Don't be profane. I mean ghosts.
My mistake, Captain.
You hear tell of ghosts appearing, haven't you?
Aye, Captain. I've heard tell of them.
Never seen them?
Never.
Neither have I. But the good book tells us they do appear. I wonder if a parson has ever seen them. Nate, just run and give the parson my compliments. And ask him if he's good enough to step here a minute.
Well, if you'll please, Captain. I was sent here with the parson's compliments and to ask if you'd be so good as to step to his cabin.
What for?
Well, the parson's in a bad way, sir.
Sick?
Shot, sir.
Shot? When?
If you please. If you please, sir. Last night while he was ashore, some tipsy oysterman let him have one while he was holding the services in the back room of the Jolly Car.
Why didn't somebody tell me?
Well, the parson would hear tell of it, Captain. Didn't want to upset you. Some of the men got him aboard and into his bunk.
But he's in a bad way, you see.
Aye, sir. Took a turn for the worse just to spell back.
Well, why didn't you tell me when you first came in?
I tried to, Captain, but...
Don't stand there spouting like a humpback whale. Get me my jacket off you on the hook.
Aye, aye, sir.
Parson's in a bad way, is he? Poor devil, having only one eye and a peg leg was bad enough without getting shot.
Your jacket, Captain.
All right, come along, Mr. Willoughby, and we'll have a look at the parson. Come on.
Captain?
Yes, Parson.
Oh, thank you, sir, for coming.
Oh, that's all right, Parson. No. Don't you try to get up now. Lie back and rest.
Thank you. I'm pretty weak.
Mate.
Captain?
Turn the lantern the other way a little. Light's right in his face.
Aye, sir.
That better, Parson?
Much. Thank you, Captain. Sorry to be so much trouble.
Oh, no trouble, man. No trouble at all.
But it won't be for long.
Why, of course not. Well, you'll be up and about deck in short order.
Pardon me for contradicting, Captain, but I'll never pace the deck again.
Being six major morbid, Parson, I'll stop thinking that way.
My time's come, Captain. I knowed it soon the bullet hit me. Funny, ain't it?
What?
How we never know how the end will come. I always hope to die in my home port, but it's to be at sea.
Oh, stop talking like that, man.
It's true, Captain. I'm dying. My race is run. Ah, you hear that?
Hear what?
Music. Heavenly music.
Where?
Here, in this cabin.
Do you hear it, Mr. Willebrand?
No.
Are you sure you heard music, Parson?
I heard it. I hear it still. Listen. Can't you hear it, too?
Would you like me to read a bit of scripture, Parson?
They're coming to take me home. God sent his angels for me. Seven, Captain.
Now, you lie back and rest, Parson.
Oh, Captain, you don't believe me. You think I'm delirious. I'm not. I see the angels and hear their music.
Yes, Parson, yes. If you say you do, you do.
The good book says God sends his angels, doesn't
it? Yes, Parson, it does. Now, what did I tell you, Mr. Willebrand? I was just sending Mr. Willebrand here for you, Parson, when he come for me. I've just been reading about that in the good book.
It's true. It's gospel. The Spirit does return. I know that I shall return, too.
Yes, Parson.
I die strong in the faith that I'll be allowed to return. And then I shall not only preach to men's souls, but I shall heal their bodies.
Flattered to the dimmer, Captain. Will I fetch some more oil?
Oh, don't bother, mate. My lantern of life is growing weaker, too. Captain.
What is it, Parson?
I always preach the truth, ain't I?
That you have.
You believe what I've told you, don't you?
Aye, but come now, lie back now. Don't lean on your elbow like that.
I must make you believe what I'm about to say. Yes. I know that I shall return this same night, this very hour, to preach to men and heal their bodies.
Aye, Parson.
Remember this, Captain. I shall come back to preach and heal their bodies.
A week later, the Ruth I. Brown caught fire from the galley stove while everybody was ashore and she burned to the water's edge. The whole town was interested in the dying prediction of the saintly old parson. Some believed it would come true. Others scoffed at it. But everyone impatiently waited for the next Christmas Eve, the first anniversary of the parson's death. One of the most ardent believers in the prophecy was little Davy, the crippled son of Captain Cobb. He constantly talked of the parson's return and hoped that he might be relieved of his crutches. Although he never expressed his opinion of the whole matter, Captain Cobb took his little son down to the wreck of the Ruth I. Brown on the appointed night.
He said he'd come back, didn't he, Father?
Aye, son.
Did he say what time?
The hour of his death, he said, baby, and that was at 8 bells.
And he will come, won't he?
He said so, baby.
I think he will. Do you think we'll be able to see him?
I don't know. Maybe.
Where was the cabin he died in, Father?
See the broken, charred wheel there?
Yes.
Well, his cabin was just after that.
I'm going up there. Maybe he'll come back for sure if I do.
Evening, Captain Cobb.
Evening, Mr. Willebrand.
Tonight's the night, ain't it?
Aye. Tonight's the night.
Folks are starting to gather, I see.
Aye.
You believe the parson will come back, don't you?
He said he would.
Yeah, he said lots of things the parson did, but I won't believe him.
Well, then, what are you here for?
Just to see all the folks get fooled.
Come to scoff, huh?
No, I wouldn't say that. Just come to look on a spell. Mind the night he died, Captain? How you been reading about the spirits coming down from heaven and how he heard them coming after him? And all that eerie music he was raving about? He and you never heard a note of it, did we?
No, mate, we didn't.
He was the only one aboard who heard or saw anything.
Aye.
Well then, Captain, how will we ever know if he comes back?
I wish I knew, mate. I wish I knew.
Eight bells, Captain.
Aye. Eight bells, mate.
Here comes the folks. They expect miracles or something.
The parson said he'd come back. Said he'd come back to preach. And heal this very hour, mate.
But do you think he'll come back, Captain?
The parson was a very honest man, mate.
Captain? Mr. Willebrand?
Oh, he meant well enough, Captain. But this coming back now.
Here I am, just as I said, Captain. Mr. Willebrand, listen to me.
He was so certain he'd return.
Yes, Captain, I promised to return, and here I am.
They say dying men have peculiar visions, Captain.
Aye, Mr. Willebrand.
Don't you hear me? I'm back with you. I've got so much to tell you.
That's why I hope I go sudden-like when it comes my turn.
Don't fear death, Mr. Willebrand. Death is peace. Death is beautiful. Oh, if you could only hear me.
Parson died easy.
Yes, Captain, I died easy.
He ain't having an easy time getting back, though.
I wonder if he will come tonight.
I'm here, Captain. I'm here. Can't you see me? I can see you. Don't you hear the music?
Wind's getting round to the north.
It'll be a cold night tonight, Captain. Might blow up a storm for morning.
I haven't much longer to stay with you, Captain. I promise you I'll get back. I want you to know I've kept my promise. Oh, there's only one way left now to make you believe.
Well, I guess the parson's failed you, Captain. Might as well get back to where it's warm.
I guess you're right, mate. I guess you're right. Oh. Where's Davy? He left me here just a few minutes ago. He went aft for the wheel there.
Oh, somebody's coming along the deck now. Is that him?
Well, must be. Nobody else up there.
Can't be, Captain. Davy'd be on his crutches.
Is Davy, and he ain't got his crutches.
Captain,
You mean?
I don't know what I mean.
Father!
Davy! Be careful! Where's your crutches, son?
I saw him, Father! I saw the parson!
Child imagines things too easily. I shouldn't have brought him. Careful, Davy. I'll come get you, son.
You don't have to, Father. See? And I'll never need my crutches again. I can walk.
Well, I'll be...
Davy! Davy, my boy! Oh, thank God. Thank God.
Did the old parson keep his promise and reappear? Full details of the story of this strange old character, as well as many other supernatural visitations, will be found under the title, The Haunted Shipwreck Off the Coast of Maine, in next Sunday's issue of the American Weekly, the magazine which is distributed with all Hearst Sunday newspapers from coast to coast. And now, on behalf of the American Weekly and all members of the Hearst organization, I wish to extend to you and your family our very best wishes for a very Merry Christmas. This is Wentworth announcing. Full details of the other stories appearing in next Sunday's issue of the American Weekly magazine will now be given to you by your own announcer.
Don't turn that dial. This is the right station if you want to hear about Jonathan Thomas and his Christmas on the Moon. Oh, my goodness, if the time draws near, I worry and worry too much, I fear, whether Jonathan Thomas will find Santa Claus, which he promised to do, and he's got to, because if he doesn't find Santa... there won't be much joy on Christmas morning without even a toy. Now, the Man in the Moon and Gorgonzola the Horse are helping Jonathan Thomas, of course. And the three little dwarfs have taught them to say, Unsqui-nunsqui-giggly-vay. It's the strangest word that you ever heard, but that's because it's a magical word. Whenever they say it, the good fairy queen knows there's trouble, and she comes to the scene, and she soon drives away the wicked old witch who rules o'er the land of Rumpelstitch. And the good fairy queen has given a charm to the travelers three to keep them from harm. 'Tis a magical acorn she gave them to take through the nightmare forest to keep them awake. 'Cause she said, remember, in the forest so deep, you'll never wake up should you go to sleep. When they reached the forest so dark and chill, they met a white squirrel named Whiskery Bill. And he was as mean as a squirrel could be. He teased them a lot from the top of a tree till Jonathan Thomas fell off of the horse and went sound to sleep, as he would, of course, for the horse held the acorn, and things looked bad, and Whiskery Bill was ever so sad till the fairy queen said, if you'll find a red rose and hold it beneath the little boy's nose, it'll wake him right up. But for miles around, there wasn't a single red rose to be found, till the white rose bush told Whiskery Bill, if she had red color, she could grow one at will. And she said, if you'll hurry right over the snow, you'll find red rubies on the long rainbow. So away he went to the rainbow's end, where he met a walrus, who became his good friend. And you've no idea how much trouble they had, for the witch did all that she could that was bad. But they found the rubies, and the bush grew the rose, They held it beneath Jonathan Thomas's nose, and he woke right up and was soon on his way, because he's got to find Santa before Christmas Day. Soon, they met a lion who asked them to dine and gave them a box full of roars that were fine to frighten the witch. Then they met the elf king, who claimed he was king of any old thing. Just then, the old witch flew up with a yell to get Jonathan Thomas and the elf king as well. But they let out the roars, which quite took her breath. As a matter of fact, it scared her to death. And then, well, here's where the story begins again.
Majesty, that's very nice.
Oh, 3 cheers isn't much. Why, it's hardly a touch. But now I give you my promise. Whatever the task, anything you ask will be yours, Master Jonathan Thomas.
Thank you very much, Your Majesty. We don't want you to give us anything, but maybe you could help us.
I'll do my best. Just give me the test.
We've got to go to the land of Squeebubble, Your Majesty, to rescue Santa Claus. Or there won't be any Christmas this year, and that would be bad, and more terribly sad, to which you'll quite agree.
Can't you help us at all, if you please?
Through this valley and over the hill, you'll find a wall that will stop you still. It's the wall of doors, and I say to you, without this key, you can't get through.
Oh, thank you, Your Majesty.
How kind of you, this thing to do. That helps us out a lot. For by my hat, any key like that could never in the world be bought.
Nobody ever told us about the Wall of Doors until you. Didn't know, did we, Mr. Man in the Moon?
How could we know if nobody told us? Unless we could guess. Look, ain't guessing such hard work.
When you come to the wall, which is very, very tall, you'll find 1,000 doors. Each one is the same, and they're all very plain. And you'll have to count them by 4s. 4 from the left, and 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 then 4 more. That makes the count 20. And that's quite a plenty. But make sure you go through the right door.
Yes, sir, Your Majesty.
Your troubles are done if you pick the right one. They'll just begin if another you go in. And you'll be lost for days. And you'll wander and wander hither and yonder, like a couple of maverick strays.
Oh, my goodness.
Is the room of doom, of never-ending night, with horrible things to give you a fright. Is a pitfall hole where goblins and snakes will give you the shakes, where ghosts and banshees wail and sneak up behind you and then try to blind you, so they can put you in jail.
I hope Santa Claus appreciates what we're going through. For I'm telling you, this sets me all a quiver. For I can't help but worry about this story, and it's got me in a dither.
Well, you needn't shake, for the door which you'll take will lead you right through the wall. So go right through, and it's easy to do. You'll not be frightened at all.
You're a very nice king, Your Majesty. I'm glad we saved you from the witch.
Oh, Jonathan Thomas, we'd better go, or we'll never get wherever we're going on time.
Yes, you'd better start walking, for I must quit talking, because I've used up most of my rhyme.
Goodbye, Your Majesty, and wish us luck. And keep your fingers crossed so we don't get stuck. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Slow. Here we go through the ice and snow. We're off again once more to find with the key which he gave to me a way through the secret door. Oh, here we go.
Squim dando, squim dandy, a frightful time do I foresee. For remember, dear children, I made a promise that I would cast the spell upon Jonathan Thomas. Now let me see, what do I need? A shell of a snail. And a watermelon seed. The boil and bubble to cause great trouble. And I'll work and toil, and I must, because they shall not rescue Santa Claus. They shall not rescue Santa Claus.
Oh, here we go through the ice and snow, singing on our way. We are riding a horse, because we have to, of course, for we have no open sleigh. Oh, jingle bells, oh, jingle bells, oh, whoa, Gorgonzola. Hold up now. My gracious to goodness and Jiminy Crickets and Flubdudge. Look, Jonathan Thomas.
Oh, it's a wall of doors. The Elf King told us about.
Doors to the left of us, doors to the right of us. Thousands and millions of doors. You could count them by 40 times 4, and they all say, Private, this means you. Now, who told them we were coming here? That's what I'd like to know.
Which is the one the Elf King told us to go through, Mr. Man in the Moon?
We'll have to count them, Jonathan Thomas. 4 from the left.
1, 2, 3... 4.
And 4 from the left.
5, 6, 7, 8.
Count 4 more or we'll be late.
9, 10, 11, 12.
It's all according to the tiny elves.
13, 14, 15, 16.
Now just 4 more and we'll open the door.
17, 18, 19, 20.
That's counting them right, which is good and plenty. Now look and see if you've got the key.
Here it is, Mr. Man in the Moon. I keep it in my pocket.
Now put it in the lock and turn to the right, and mighty soon we'll know what we will greet here to our sight.
Oh, look, Mr. Man in the Moon. It's kind of spooky inside.
The Elf King said we had nothing to fear, but I don't ever fear nothing. It's always something I'm afraid of. Come on, Jonathan Thomas, shut the door and let's go on.
Oh, I hope we can it right, because remember, he said if we didn't, we'd get into all sorts of trouble.
You counted right, of course you did, and I'm not afraid.
I'm not afraid.
Oh.
Oh.
Who said that?
Who said that?
Somebody's mocking us.
Mocking us?
But who could it be?
Who could it be?
Whoever it is, they'd better shut up.
Shut up.
Oh, look at the man in the moon. Look at all the people.
People.
And they're coming after us.
After
Come you. On, Jonathan Thomas. Run for your life. Run for your life.
Run for your life. Run for your life.
Well, my goodness gracious. It looks like Jonathan Thomas and the man in the moon are in trouble again. But what sort of trouble do you think? What sort of a place are they in? That's what I'd like to know, wouldn't you? Well, we'll find out when we hear the next story of Jonathan Thomas and his Christmas on the Moon. Don't forget to listen, will you?